بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له ولي الصالحين واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله الداعي الى صراط مستقيم صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى اله وصحبه ومن سار على نهجه واقتفى اثره ليوم الدين اما بعد اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا يا رب العالمين وجعلنا هداة مهتدين غير الضالين ولا مضلين برحمتك أرحم الراحمين أيها الإخوة الأخوات إن شاء الله تعالى we are going to be continuing our lesson on the names of Allah تبارك وتعالى and we have previously covered in the previous lessons the name Allah الرب الرحمن الرحيم and then we had الكريم and الودود And we also had Al-A'la Al-Muta'ali as well. All of these names that we covered in our previous lessons, telling us about our Creator, our Maker, Allah Azza wa Jal. Because knowing the names of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, it is what makes us love our Creator even more. And be amazed by Allah Azza wa Jal's greatness. So that we obey Him Jalla fi Ulah, worship Him due to His might and greatness Jalla fi Ulah. Insha'Allah Ta'ala, today we're going to be continuing from the name or the two names Al-Ghafoor and Al-Ghaffar. Al-Ghafoor and Al-Ghaffar. Tafadhal, Ya Abdurrahman.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Al-Ghafoor, God forgiven. Al-Ghaffar, the all forgiven. Allah the Exalted says, Labbi' ibadi anni an al-Ghafoor ar-Rahim. Meaning, declare Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam unto my slaves that truly I am the all forgiven and most merciful. And Allah the Exalted also says, فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا Meaning, I said to them, ask forgiveness from your Lord, verily He is of forgiven.
نعم, Allah تبارك وتعالى, this name, Al-Ghafoor and Al-Ghaffar, they are mentioned in the Qur'an a lot. And when a name is mentioned in the Qur'an a lot, Allah تبارك وتعالى is calling us to مقتضى هذا الاسم, what this name necessitates. In the previous ayah, the first ayah, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He says, نَبِّعْ عِبَادِي Inform my slaves, أَنِّي أَنَا الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ That I am Al-Ghafoor, the oft-forgiving. And we're going to find out what exactly the difference is between Al-Ghafoor and Ghaffar. In the other ayah, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, about Nuh alayhi salam, that He said to His people, فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبُّكُمْ I said to my people, seek forgiveness from Allah. إِنَّهُ verily He is غَفَّارًا غَفَّار, the one who forgives a lot. Now we're going to find out now what is the difference between these two names. Tafadhal.
Linguistic meaning. Ghaffar means to cover and conceal. Religious meaning. Allah the Exalted is Al-Ghafoor Al-Ghaffar. The concealer of his slaves' sins, the one who covers their sins so that none sees them but him, overlooking their flaws. He the Exalted forgives the slaves' sins time after time, forever for whenever the slave repeats his repentance of the sin. Is Lord
peace, is forgiveness. Now, so when we are talking about maghfirah, forgiveness, this name linguistically, what does it come from in the Arabic language? It comes from a word known as as-sitr. And as-sitr, it is concealment. So when you're asking Allah for forgiveness, you are asking Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to conceal your faults. That is number one. And also, from the meanings of al-maghfirah, it is al-wiqaya, protection. Meaning that you're seeking Allah's protection from your sins, the consequences of your sins. So when you're asking Allah for forgiveness, it entails these two meanings. Number one, you're asking Allah to conceal your faults and sins. Number two, you're asking Allah to protect you from the consequences of your sins. Because al-maghfirah comes from the word al-mighfar. Mighfar in Arabic means the helmet. Right? And what does the helmet do? It protects you. And it also comes from al-ghafr, which means as-sitr, concealment, right? So that's when you're asking Allah Azza for maghfirah, that's what you're asking for. Now,
the difference in meaning is al-ghafur is the one who forgives the sins no matter how large they may be, and al-ghafar is the one who forgives the sins no matter how frequent they may occur. Therefore, al-ghafur for the type of sins, and al-ghafar for the quantity of sins.
Now, the difference between al-ghafur and ghafar. Al-Ghafoor, it is min siyagh al-mubalagha in Arabic language. Meaning it's an exaggerated noun. It is an exaggerated noun. It means that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is the one who always forgives, constantly is forgiving. And the greatest sins, the sins that you think are the greatest, Al-Ghafoor is the one who forgives them. That's why Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, when He talks about the great sins that you may think that Allah may not forgive, He ends it with the name Al-Ghafoor. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Say, O my slaves, say, O Muhammad, to my servants, my slaves who have transgressed against themselves, meaning that they committed every sin out there, every single sin, to the extent they may think that khalas, I'm not going to be forgiven by Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala due to the severity of my sins. I have killed, I have committed fornication, I have done this and this and all the major sins. Allah says, لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله, do not despair from the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Why? Allah forgives all sins. And to reiterate that, Allah ends the ayah with, إِنَّهُ رَوْلِ, He is Al-Ghafoor, the one who's always forgiving the greatest sins. Ar-Rahim, the most merciful, especially merciful to the believers. A question. If someone was to commit the worst sin, what is the worst sin that one can commit? Huh? Ash-Shirk. Will Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala forgive shirk? No. If someone commits shirk, Allah will forgive them. Subhanallah. But Allah is Al-Ghafoor. And you're saying Allah won't forgive shirk. He won't forgive the person if he commits shirk.
Now, if they ask for forgiveness before they die, but if they die without asking?
Ahsant. That's the difference. Allah forgives everything, even shirk. It means that the ayah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ, that Allah does not forgive, that you associate partners with Him, that you commit shirk. It means that one who dies upon shirk without repenting from it. One who committed shirk without repenting from it, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, Yawm al-Qiyamah, will not forgive him. But one who commits shirk and falls into shirk whilst he's alive and then repents whilst he's alive, Allah will forgive him. He's Al-Ghafoor. يَغْفِرُ الدُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. But my question is shirk the worst sin? Are you all in agreement that shirk is the worst sin? Huh? Is there nothing worse than shirk? Huh? Despairing from Allah's mercy is worse than shirk. Not quite. Sorry? Killing, killing is not worse than shirk. Is there anything that's worse than shirk that one can commit?
Saying that you are Allah.
That's basically shirk. Sorry? Mixing a prayer is a major sin, but it's not worse than shirk.
Major shirk.
Major shirk is shirk. Disobeying your parents is not worse than shirk. Na'am, Shaykh Salah al-Din. Allah. Al-Shaykh ya'rif, ta'wan. Al-Shaykh ta'wan ya'rif. He said the answer, but did you guys understand what he said?
No, I
didn't. Ah, we can still test you guys.
Leaving Islam?
Leaving Islam, yani shirk. You're still in shirk. أها نعم أن تقولوا على الله ما لا تعلمون. That you say about Allah تبارك وتعالى that which you do not know, it is worse than shirk. The ulama, they say it. Why? Because in the ayah that Allah تبارك وتعالى, He lists the major sins, okay, then Allah تبارك, He ends it with shirk, which is what we know is the worst, right? And then Allah says, وَأَن تُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يُنَزِّلْ بِهِ سُلْطَانًا وَأَن تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah was listing the sins in the order of severity. Allah said that you associate partners of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, shirk. And then that you say about Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala that which you do not know. Talking about Islam, the religion of Allah, and Allah based on ignorance, that is worse than shirk. The ulama, they say, why? Because it leads to shirk. It leads to disbelief. It leads to innovation. It leads to major sins. It leads to all the corruption that deen of Allah Ta'ala could be distorted. So no doubt, it leads to all these catastrophes. So it is worse than shirk, the ulama rahmatullah alayhi, they say. And that's why one has to be extremely wary that he talks about the deen of Allah And Allah Azza wa Jal, based on ignorance, if you do not know, your honor lies in saying, I do not know. That's honorable. But if you talk about something that you do not know, then Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala hold you accountable for the consequences that come from that. Because you're going to misguide others. You're going to misguide yourself. You're going to accumulate all the sins of those who follow you in that misguidance, and so on. And this pleases Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. And that's why the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, like Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he would be asked questions by people seeking fatwa, an Islamic ruling. And then he would answer saying, I do not know. I do not know. I do not know. And then they would say to him, but you're Abdullah ibn Umar. If you don't know, then who knows? And then he would say, you know these people here who are asking all these questions? They want to make our backs bridges to the hellfire by us giving wrong information we do not know. A man came to Imam Malik, Imam Malik ibn Anas, Imam Dar Hijra, the great Imam, from far. He had many questions, he asked all the questions. Majority of the questions, Imam Malik said, La adri, I don't know, Allahu a'lam, Allahu a'lam, Allah knows best. Because saying I do not know, it is nisful ilm, half a knowledge. And that's how much fear they had of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, that they would utter anything that was wrong. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he would be asked a meaning of an ayah. And the Sahaba knew the Quran, the meaning of the Quran. But if they weren't certain, they wouldn't answer. And then he would be asked why. And he would say, Ayyu sama tudhilluni. He said, which sky is going to shade me? And which land is going to hold me? If I say about the speech of Allah Azza wa Jalla, that which I do not know, the Quran. But if someone commits that, Al-Ghafoor will forgive that if he repents to Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. And he rectifies his mistakes and he clarifies. Because, you know, when you repent from a sin that affects others and may lead to the misguidance of others, you have to do something known as clarification. If you don't and just repent between you and Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala without clarifying to the masses and they're still misguided, you're responsible for that. Because Allah says, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ تَابُوا وَأَصْلَحُوا وَبَيَّنُوا. Those who repent and rectify their state and they clarify, the clarification is required. You must do that. But if it's a sin that's between you and Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala that doesn't affect anyone else, then you repent between you and Allah in secret. And Allah will forgive you. But the maghfirah, the forgiveness of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, it is that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, if you can see your faults and your sins, and then you see forgiveness from Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala for these sins, Allah will forgive you. And conceal your faults. As we have in the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will summon his slave yawm al-qiyamah and he will say to him, Ya Abdi, fa'alta kada, yawma kada, wa kada. You did this on that day and that day. And the slave will admit it and acknowledge it. And then Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will say to him, I have concealed it for you in the dunya and I am going to conceal it for you here and forgive it for you. That's those who conceal their sins. And don't make it public. But the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he says, كل أمتي معافى إلا المجاهرون. All of my ummah shall be forgiven, except those who openly sin and they publicly sin and they make their sins public for everyone to see. Those people, for Allah to forgive them, it takes a lot. It's not impossible, but it takes a lot. You see the severity of sinning publicly because others are going to imitate you in that evil. And what it does, it makes it seem normal. People won't be shy of doing it anymore. And all this corruption that happens, Allah and His Messenger are warning us from that. Now, Kamil.
The grandeur of Al-Ghafoor and Al-Ghafoor. These two names indicate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's concealment, His covering the ugly things so as no one sees them, forgiving them and overlooking. Allah's two names, Al-Ghafoor and Al-Ghafoor, are so grand that no matter how great the slaves of sin is, if you repent and assess oneness, monotheism of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive it. It is said in Al-Hadith, Qudsi, O son of Adam, if your sins reach the height of the sky and then you ask for my forgiveness, I will forgive you and I will not care. O son of Adam, if you come to me carrying sins the size of the earth, not associating anything with me, having pure monotheism, I will come to me you with nearly an equivalent size of forgiveness.
Now, the greatness of this name, these two names, Al-Ghafur and Al-Ghaffar, would come from the same asr. It is that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, nothing is too great for Allah to forgive. But Allah's forgiveness is greater than every sin. And Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala forgives and forgives and forgives. As Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says, يَسْأَلُهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ هُوَ فِي شَأْنٍ. Every day Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is in an affair. The Muhasirun, they say the meaning of this, it is يَغْفِرُ دَنْبًا وَيَسْتُرُ عَيْبًا وَيَرْزُقُ فَقِيرًا إِلَىٰ آخِرِهِ. That Allah Tabaraka, He forgives sins every single day. He is conceding faults. Allah Tabaraka providing for those who need sustenance and so on. Every single day. As we have in the Hadith Qudsi, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he narrates from Allah Tabaraka that Allah said, يَبْنَ آدَمْ, O son of Adam, لَوْ بَلَغَتْ ذُنُوبُكَ عَنَانَ السَّمَاءِ, if your sins, they reach the heavens, they fill up the heavens, what's in between the heavens and the earth. ثُمَّ اسْتَغْفَرْتَنِي, then you sought forgiveness. غَفَرْتُ لَكَ وَلَا أُبَارِي, I will forgive you and I do not mind. Allah wants to forgive you. يَبْنَ آدَمْ, O son of Adam, لَوْ أَتَيْتَنِي بِقُرَابِ الْأَرْضِ خَطَايَا, if you come to me with the size of the earth of sins, the size of this whole planet of sins. ثُمَّ لَقِيتَنِي لَا تُشْرِكُ بِي شَيْئًا, and then you come to me not associate any partners with me, يعني you have full tawheed. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says, لَأَتَيْتُكَ بِقُرَابِهَا مَغْفِرًا, I'll come to you with the same size of the earth of forgiveness. Allahu Akbar. And this hadith, it shows the greatness of tawheed, the oneness of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala in your heart, that you observe and preserve and look after this tawheed that's in your heart. It's the most precious thing that you possess. Believing in the oneness of Allah and worshipping Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala based on that, and not associating with any partners of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, avoiding major shirk and minor shirk. And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, the matter that he was most afraid of for this ummah was الشرك الخفي, the hidden shirk. The Sahaba, they asked him, Ya Rasulullah, what is hidden shirk? He said, it is الرياء, showing off. الرياء والسمعة وما شابه, showing off and doing things for the creation and not doing it for Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. This is minor shirk, and the consequences of minor shirk, it is that it destroys your righteous deeds. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. It has been royalty of Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام, and those before you, that if you commit shirk, your deeds will become void and you'll be amongst the losers يوم القيامة. My major shirk takes one out of the fold of Islam. Minor shirk makes your deeds void. And this is something the Prophet ﷺ was afraid for, or afraid of for this ummah. And he taught us ﷺ a dua that one should say to protect himself from this matter. He would say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اللهم إني أعوذ بك أن أشرك بك وأنا أعلم وأستغفرك لما لا أعلم, which means, O Allah, I seek refuge in you that I associate partners with you whilst I know, I do it knowingly, and I seek your forgiveness for that which I do not know. You may fall into it and you have no idea. Repeat after me this dua. It's a dua azim. You should try to memorize it. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an ushrika bika wa ana a'lam wa astaghfiruka lima la a'lam. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an ushrika bika وأنا أعلم وأستغفرك لما لا أعلم. اللهم إني أعوذ بك أن أشرك بك وأنا أعلم وأستغفرك لما لا أعلم. Try to memorize this dua. Dua azim that protects your tawheed for you, the greatest thing that you possess. And from the greatness of his name, it is that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he repeats this name in the Quran numerous times. And a lot of the time his name is mentioned in the Quran, it is accompanied by Ar-Rahim, the most merciful, the especially merciful. And this is indicating that from the rahmah of Allah, from the mercy of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, it is that he forgives you. Ar-Rahma Ashmal. The rahmah is more comprehensive, the mercy of Allah. Because we define the rahmah as what? I told you guys, I was going to ask you again. What's his definition of rahmah?
It is basically where Allah gives you the best of this dunya. So basically, he gives you things that is good for you in this dunya.
Mm-hmm.
And then, no. The mercy of Allah,
you're right,
is that he gives you what's good for you for the akhirah. So that, like, he protects you from what's bad for you in the akhirah.
Uh-huh. What about the dunya? Nothing.
The goodness of this dunya and the goodness in the hereafter as well, no?
Is that it?
No, there's more to it. But
there's more to it. What's more is to it? Yes, hi. Punishment only. It's broader than that. Huh? Man ya'rif. Huh?
And that Allah will give you everything that's good in this world and hereafter and will prevent you from everything that is harmful.
Now, it's a broad definition like that. That Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala's mercy is that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala grants you everything that's beneficial for you and good for you in this world and hereafter. And Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala protects you from everything that is harmful to you in this world and hereafter. That is rahmah. So when you're seeking the rahmah of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, no doubt the maghfirah, forgiveness, is part of the rahmah of Allah because it's beneficial for you in this world and hereafter. And it protects you from the consequences of your sins in this world and the hereafter. Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, Shaykh al-Islam, he says, إِنَّ لِلذُّنُوبِ عُقُوبَاتِ. He says, sins, they have punishments and consequences in this world, before even the hereafter. And then he says, أَسِّرُّ بِالسِّرِّ وَالْعَلَانِيَ بِالْعَلَانِيَ. He says, the sins that are committed in private, they have secret and private punishments. And the sins that are committed in public, they have public punishments and consequences. What does it mean by that? If you commit a sin that only Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala knows about, no one else knows about, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will afflict you with a punishment, the consequence that only Allah knows about and you, no one else knows about it. Perhaps it may be that you're feeling certain mental illness and so on that you're suffering from due to a sin that you committed. It may be that case. That you're suffering from anxiety and all this stuff and distress and depression and so on due to a sin that you have committed. It could be the consequence of that. And just like that, the one who commits sins in public, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala may afflict him with a consequence of punishment that is public for everyone to see, just like he did a sin in public. It doesn't necessarily mean, by the way, that mental illnesses are always because of sins. They have many factors that cause it, but it could be. And many other secret punishments that may occur. This is just an example. But when you seek forgiveness of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, you repent immediately, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will protect you from those consequences. And if your situation was bad before you repented, the ulama, they say, your situation will be even better than it was initially. It will be even better because of the tawbah. Ibn Taymiyyah, he says that, he reports that some of the Salaf, rahmatullahi alayhim, he says in the Majmu' al-Fatawa, that they would say that Allah, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, he tests some of his righteous servants with sins, or certain sins that they tested with. So that they repent to him, جل في علا, because of how much Allah loves repentance. I'll repeat that. He says that Allah tests his righteous slaves with certain sins that they find difficult to give up, and they keep falling into again, and they keep repenting because of how much Allah loves repentance. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ وَيُحِبُّ الْمُتَطَّهِرِينَ. Verily Allah loves التَّوَّابِينَ, those who repent frequently. وَيُحِبُّ الْمُتَطَّهِرِينَ, and He loves those who purify themselves. That's what Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ وَيُحِبُّ الْمُتَطَّهِرِينَ. Rather, the Prophet ﷺ tells in the hadith that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, He is happier and rejoices more than the one who went traveling in the desert and he had his camel and all his goods were on that camel, and then he lost his camel and all his goods, and then he slept out of despair, and then he woke up and found his camel on top of him with all his goods, and then he said out of joy, Allahumma anta abdi wa ana rabbuk. Oh Allah, you are my slave and I am your Lord. He made a mistake because of how happy he was. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is happy in that individual when you repent to Allah Azza wa Jal. Imagine, when you seek the maghfirah and the forgiveness of Allah and you repent to Allah Azza wa Jal, that is what you get. You make Allah happy and Allah loves you. One of the ulama, the salaf, was asked, how frequently should I seek the forgiveness of Allah and repent to Allah? And then he responded by saying, until shaitan gives up. Is shaitan going to give up? La, he made a promise he won't. Until shaitan gives up, meaning until you meet Allah Azza wa Jalla on Qiyamah. Keep repenting, every sin you commit, repent. And look at the rahmah of Allah, the mercy of Allah, tabarak. The Prophet alayhi salatu tells us, that when a slave, he repents to Allah and seeks forgiveness of Allah, when the slave commits a sin, the Prophet ﷺ says, إِذَا أَذْنَبَ الْعَبْدُ, if the slave commits a sin, and when he commits a sin, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, after he commits a sin, he makes the angel on the left wait for 6 hours. It will not recall that sin for 6 hours. Waiting for him to repent within those 6 hours. If he repents in those 6 hours, nothing's recorded. If he doesn't repent in those 6 hours, one sin is recorded. Whereas the angel on the right, as soon as he commits a good deed, or you do a good deed, it writes it immediately as 10. Not one. But the sin, one. After 6 hours, not immediately. رَحْمَهُ اللَّهُ تَبَارَكُ وَتَعَالَى غَفُورٌ. He wants to forgive you. But all it takes is for you to seek that forgiveness. Shaitan, what does he do? When you commit a sin, he makes you feel the incorrect guilt. I call it false guilt. He'll say to you, you're not deserving of the mercy of Allah and the forgiveness of Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala. You're filthy, how can you go in front of Allah like this? This is from his tricks. Rather, the guilt that you feel, it should motivate you to repent. Because repent, it is remorse and regret. As the Prophet ﷺ said, At-tawbatu nadam. That repentance, it is remorse and regret. And it's one of the conditions of repentance, that you regret what you have done, and you don't want to go back to that sin, and you leave everything that can lead to that sin and help you fall into it again. That is the conditions that are required in order for Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to accept your repentance. Now, the next name, Al-Aziz, tafadhal.
Al-Aziz. Power, dominance, immunity, and is designated to the glorious, honest, and unequal person. Religious meaning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala owns all meanings of might, power in their clearest and purest forms, for He is the conqueror, the victorious, who cannot be defeated. He is the immune that cannot be touched or harmed. He has full greatness, He is unparalleled, there is no equal, and none is similar unto Him. He humiliates not His worshippers, gives might to whoever He wills. And He makes people of faith victorious and humiliates people of disobedience.
Now, Al-Aziz, this is the next name. The Almighty, the one who possesses all of might. Al-Izzah, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, Inna al-Izzata lillahi jami'a. Verily, all of Izzah, might and honor and glory, it has all of these meanings, belongs to Allah Azza wa Jalla. All of it. It is with Allah. Wa inna rabbaka lahuwa al-Azizu al-Rahim. And your Lord, He is Al-Aziz, the Almighty, Al-Rahim, the Most Merciful. Now notice these two names mentioned together. Aziz, Al-Rahim. We mentioned as well when we explained the name Al-Rahim. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He mentions the name Al-Rahim and Aziz together. Why? Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He's showing us that His mercy, it is not out of weakness, but is with full Izzah. Others might be merciful to others because they are weak. They have no other choice. But Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, with all His might and power and glory, He is merciful. Especially merciful, the most merciful. وَإِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَهُوَ الْعَزِيزِ The Almighty, Ar-Rahim, the most merciful. Part of His Izzah is His Ar-Rahim. This name, it means, religiously, that there is no one who is mightier than Allah. And there is no one who is more glory, who deserves more glory than Allah. And no one above Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala shows the perfection of Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ الْعِزَّةَ فَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةُ جَمِيعًا Whoever wants Izzah, honor and might and authority and everything that comes with it. فَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةُ جَمِيعًا Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, with Him is all Izzah, all of might, all of honor, all of glory. Seek it from Allah, He's telling you. Alone, nowhere else. Seek it through the deen of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Seek it from Allah Azza wa Jalla, the most mighty. Because when you do so, Allah will grant you it. Like Umar radiallahu anhu wa radahi, he would say, نَحْنُ قَوْمٌ أَعَزَّنَ اللَّهُ بِالْإِسْلَامِ We are a people, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He honored and He granted them might and glory through Islam. Whenever we seek that might elsewhere, other than Islam, أَذَلَّنَ اللَّهُ Allah will humiliate us and make us low. All of Izzah is with Allah, Islam. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He the Sahaba, the Arabs, how were they before Islam? They were those who weren't respected by the other nations. Nobody respected them. Everyone saw them as ignorant Bedouins who just looked after their camels and their sheep and so on, their cattle. But when Islam came, the Sahaba, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, allowed them to conquer the great empires of that time, the Roman Empire, the Persian Empire, who were the greats at that time? Bil Islam. Because the Izzah is from Allah. One of the Sahaba, he entered upon the ruler of the Romans, the Roman Empire, Hiraql. And then he had a conversation with him. He was sent as a messenger. He had a conversation with him. And Hiraql was one who was familiar with Islam because they were people of the book. They had the things, they were, you know, their scripture had the scripture of the Prophet alayhi salam. And previously when Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu, before he was Muslim, they went to those lands for trade. They met him and he asked them about the Prophet alayhi salatu salam and his attributes. And when they described them, Hiraql knew that this was truly a prophet. Because this is the traits that they have read in their scripture. This Sahabi, Hiraql wanted to scare him and make him fear him. But he saw that this Sahabi did not fear him at all. He threatened his life. He said, it didn't make him change his mind at all. He said to Hiraql, we are a people that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He took them out from being enslaved to the slaves, to the Lord, and being enslaved to the Lord of the slaves, Allah. We were enslaved to the creation previously, and to our desires and so on. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala took us out from that, and He made us those who are His slaves, who serve Him. And this is where we got our glory from. He was amazed by that. He let him go after that because of what he said. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, he says in the Quran, وَإِنَّهُ لَذِكْرٌ لَكَ وَلِقَوْمِكَ وَسَوْفَ تُسْأَلُونَ. Verily, this Quran, it is an honor for you, and in it is your might, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and your people, and you shall be asked about Yawm al-Qiyamah. Meaning that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, he raises you with this deen and this scripture and this book. And he allowed the Sahaba radiallahu anhu to open all these lands and to conquer it because of Islam. If it wasn't for Islam, that would not be the case. To the extent that the Persians, when their empire collapsed, they came to Medina, they sent a messenger to Medina in the time of Umar radiallahu anhu. And the messenger, he's thinking, there's a great king in Medina who destroyed the Persian empire. So he comes to Medina, they say, where is he? He says, where is the Khalifa? Where is Umar? They tell him he's in the masjid. The masjid looks like a humble, simple masjid. He enters it, he sees it sad, and he sees someone sleeping there. He said, that's him. And then he said his famous words, حَكَمْتَ عَدَلْتَ أَمِنْتَ فَنِمْتَ. He said, you ruled. And you were just in your rule. So you slept without a worry to worry about. Safe. Nothing to worry about. This is the man that destroyed the Persian Empire. To the extent that the Persians, at that time, they hated Umar so much that the man who assassinated Umar was from there. Fayruz, his name was. Abu Lu'la al-Majusi. He came to Medina as a slave of Al-Mughira ibn Shu'ba radiallahu anhu. He was a blacksmith. And he hated Umar. He pretended to like him. He spent months poisoning a dagger so that he can assassinate Umar radiallahu anhu. And then he came Salat al-Fajr and it's dark. They didn't have lights in the masjid. And he stabbed Umar. And he stabbed about 9 of the Sahaba who were in the front row as well, whilst in sujood. And he made sure that if the dagger did not kill him, that the poison would kill him eventually. Radiallahu an Umar, he got shahada, died as a martyr, as the Prophet alayhi sallam gave him that prophecy. From the lataif of this name, that it's paired up with certain names in the Quran. And when the names we said in our previous lessons, that when certain names are paired up in the Quran, it is not for no reason. There's a reason behind it. There's a benefit behind it. We mentioned early on that the name Al-Aziz, it is paired up with Ar-Rahim. وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الرَّحِيمُ وَإِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الرَّحِيمُ. This form, وَإِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الرَّحِيمُ, it reoccurs in Surah Al-Shu'ara 8 times. After Allah Tabarakat, he mentions the story of each prophet. When he mentioned Ibrahim alayhi salam, Nuh alayhi salam, Lut, and so on, the different prophets. When Allah mentioned them, he ended each story with وَإِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الرَّحِيمُ, indicating what? That Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, with his rahmah and his mercy, he saved these prophets and their people from his mercy. And with his izzah and might, he destroyed their enemies and those who tried to harm them and who were enemies of the deen. Because all the stories, they spoke about how Allah Tabarak was saved that prophet and his people, and he destroyed the enemy. So Allah Tabarak ended it, وَإِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَهُ الْعَزِيزُ الرَّحِيمُ, each time, 8 times in Surah Al-Shu'ara. You have also that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he says in the Quran, لا إله إلا هو العزيز الحكيم. There is no deity worthy of worship except him, Al-Aziz, the Almighty, Al-Hakim, the All-Wise. It is from Allah paired this name Al-Aziz with Al-Hakim, the Wise, the Most Wise, the All-Wise, indicating that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, his Izzah, his might, it is accompanied by wisdom. That the Izzah, because what is wisdom, Ya Kiram? Well, who knows what wisdom is? Huh?
Is it doing the thing at its befitting time and how it should be done and when it should be done?
Nah. Al-Hikmah, it is to do the right thing at the right time, in the right place, in the right method. That's wisdom. To do the right thing, you should write this down really. it's quite important, is to do the right thing, wisdom. At the right time, in the right place, and in the right method. To do the right thing, at the right time, in the right place, and in the correct method. That is wisdom. So Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, His Izzah, His Might, it is always at the appropriate time, in the appropriate place, in the right method. Because of Allah's wisdom, His Hikmah, His complete wisdom. Izzah is accompanied by that. And that shows the perfection of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Because there are those who possess might, but do not have wisdom. And they use their might in the wrong places and they cause oppression. But Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, وَمَا رَبُّكَ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ, your Lord is not oppressive to His slaves. Allah Tabaraka does not oppress His slaves. What are the fruits and the effect that this name Al-Aziz should have upon us? Yani, how do you worship Allah Tabaraka with this name Al-Aziz? This name Al-Aziz, it should embed in us that I do not humiliate myself for anyone other than Allah. And I lower myself. I do not lower myself for anyone other than Allah. That's number one. Lowering yourself in front of Allah is a strength, whereas lowering yourself in front of creation is weakness. Every time you lower yourself in front of Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, you humble yourself in front of Allah, that is a strength. But whenever you do it in front of the creation, that is weakness. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala warns against that. That's number one. It is also the benefit that we take from this name Al-Aziz. It is that we follow the deen of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, in order to attain izzah, might, as we mentioned in the beginning. In order to attain might and honor and glory, it is through following the religion of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and the path of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Because Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala tells us that izzah, this might, is for His righteous slaves. Because Allah says, وَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةِ وَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةُ وَلِرَسُولِهِ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلَكِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Allah says, to Allah belongs all izzah, all might and honor and glory. And His Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, and the believers, His righteous slaves. But the hypocrites do not know. Also, the one who wants to attain that izzah, it is bi kathrati sujood, by increasing your prostration to Allah tabaraka specifically. And in salah, you volunteer prayers. When there was sahabi, he used to serve the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. His name is Rabi'ah. So one day the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said to him, after he saw yani, how well he had been serving him, the Prophet ﷺ said, "Sell ya Rabi'ah, ask for anything, O Rabi'ah. Whatever you ask for, I'll give it to you." So he was a young boy. Rabi'ah radiallahu anhu, he went quiet and he said, "Ya Rasulullah, give me some time, let me think about it." So he came back the next day. And the Prophet ﷺ said, what did you want to ask, ya Rabi'ah? Yalla, sell, ask, request for anything. And then he said, "As'aluka murafaqataka fi jannah, I ask you for your companionship in Jannah, to be your neighbor and companion in Jannah, ya Rasulullah." After he said that, look at this great, the Prophet, this great yani, ambition that he has. The Prophet said, "Is that all? Nothing else, ya Rabi'ah?" Yani, he's telling him that he still have an opportunity to ask for anything worldly if you want as well. He said, "That's it, ya Rasulullah. Because of you having that mindset, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala Al-Aziz will grant you izzah, will honor you in this world and hereafter." So the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, after he asked that, he told him, أعني على نفسك بكثرة السجود. In order to get there, Ya Rabi'a, and to fulfill your request, help me by increasing your sujood, i.e. your voluntary prayers. Sujood. Why the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام mentioned sujood? Because sujood, it is what the salah is known for first. Number one, it's a sign of salah. Secondly, it is when you place the lowest, the highest part of your body on the ground in front of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, lowering yourself for Allah Azza wa Jal, indicating when you lower yourself for Allah, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala raise you, elevate you, grant you His might and honor. Also, from the ways of implementing this name in our lives, it is that you implement the ayah that Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَخْفِضْ جَنَاحَكَ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Lower your wing of mercy to the believers, be merciful to the believers. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla says that the believers, they are أَذِلَّةٍ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَعِزَّةٍ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. The believers, they are those who are humble with the believers, they are merciful towards the believers. But they are harsh with the disbelievers who are their enemies. They are harsh towards the disbelievers who are their enemies. So that's how you implement that name. And it is from the ways that you implement this name, it is that you pardon and forgive those who harm you. It is that you pardon and forgive those who harm you. Because the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he says, وَمَا زَادَ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا بِعَفْوٍ إِلَّا عِزَّا وَمَنْ تَوَاضَعَ عَبْدٌ لِلَّهِ إِلَّا رَفَعَهُ. He said عليه الصلاة والسلام that a slave is not increased with his forgiving of others and pardoning others except in عِزًا, might and honor and glory. The more you forgive others and pardon others, Allah honors you and grants you might, and Allah Ta'ala will also forgive you. And he said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, وَمَا تَوَاضَعَ عَبْدُ لِلَّهِ إِلَّا رَفَعَ. And no one humbles himself for Allah Ta'ala except Allah Azza wa Jalla elevates him. This is how one can live by this name, Al-Aziz. This is the effect that this name is meant to have upon us, and the benefits that we take from this name. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala bi asma'i al-husna wa sifati al-ula to forgive our sins. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to have mercy upon us. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to make us into righteous slaves. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to grant us His izzah. We ask Allah Jalla fi ula to grant us His rahmah. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to guide us and to guide others through us and to increase us in guidance. And we ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to grant us taqwa, and to accept our deeds and to protect us from associating partners with Him. And we ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to grant us sincerity in our statements and actions. Innahu wali dhalik wal qadir alayhi wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak alayhi nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Any questions? No.
Dr. Lassad, we see when you're talking about how since you do have punishments in this life as well as the next, is being punished for sin you committed that your repentance was accepted, or?
So, Jameel, the question was that we mentioned that the sins that we commit in this world, they have consequences in this world before the hereafter, and some punishments in this world before the hereafter. And the question was, is that a sign that when you face these consequences in this world, that your repentance is accepted? The answer to that question is that these consequences, they occur when you do not repent in the first place. If you repent, Allah Ta'ala protects you from those consequences, because we said al-maghfirah, forgiveness, it is part of its meaning as well, it is al-wiqaya, protection. It prevents from the calamities occurring, the punishment occurring, and so on, because Allah Ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. That Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He's not going to punish them as long as you are alive and amongst them, O Muhammad alayhi salatu salam. And Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will not punish them as long as they seek forgiveness. Meaning that forgiveness is what prevents the punishment of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. But that was referring to the one who commits sins and doesn't repent from them. It is from the rahmah of Allah, from the mercy of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, that Allah, He afflicts you with a punishment, that Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he says that Allah, He punishes you in this world before instead of the hereafter, not before, instead of the hereafter. Because, but when is it rahmah? When that punishment that you face as well, it turns you back to Allah. Because Allah says, وَلَنُذِيقَنَّهُمْ مِنْ الْعَذَابِ الْأَدْنَى دُونَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَكْبَرِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. That will make them taste the smaller punishment in this world. دُونَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَكْبَرِ, instead of the greater punishment in the hereafter, the hellfire. Why? So that they repent. So it's part of Allah's rahmah that Allah, He makes you go through certain difficulties and calamities to expiate your sins, number one. And number two, so that you repent to Him and seek His forgiveness so that you don't have to face that great punishment in the hereafter. Wallahu A'lam.